Anja, thanks so much for inviting me. It's really a pleasure to be here tonight and to share with you some of our expertise on hybrid finance. And I would love to touch on three points in the next 20 minutes. So the first one is to briefly recap what the concept of social entrepreneurship and impact investing means. Then secondly, explore a bit and share our learnings of the challenges of social enterprises in getting appropriate financing, and then share some concrete examples from our work with social entrepreneurs and support to them in raising funds, so that you see some concrete examples how this hybrid finance can work in practice. So just as a brief recap and starting position, as probably not all of us are so familiar with the concept of social entrepreneurship, so it's basically an intersection between for-profit and non-profit. And the idea is really to use business means to tackle societal issues. And social entrepreneurship is a still modern phenomenon that is en vogue, and it's actually more relevant probably to our lives than you might think about. So Jimmy Wales, for example, is a Ashoka fellow that founded Wikipedia. And how many times, who has used already Wikipedia this week? Hands up. Yeah, so it's really changed the way how we organize knowledge. Another Ashoka fellow from Germany, and I will talk about him in greater detail later on, Frank Hoffmann. So he's a medical doctor himself, and he trains blind women to detect breast cancer. Because of their superior tactile senses, they are in a better position actually to detect the breast cancer compared to a standard examination that a doctor can do. So that just as a small recap of the concept of social entrepreneurship. And impact investing is also something that combines, is at the section of investment and philanthropy. So it basically means something that tries to generate both a financial return and a measurable social impact. And there are different synonyms that are used for it. And I just wanted to share one definition by the Global Impact Investing Network. So stating that impact investments are investments made into companies, organizations, and funds with the intention to generate social and environmental impact alongside a financial return. So if you want to summarize this, doing well by doing good. And what does it mean, this double bottom line premise? So you see that there's from the social investment, there is a return for the investor, but there's also a larger return for society. And that is important to understand also in terms of the trade-offs that you see in the market. So there are some people that promise that you can have everything, that you can save the world and beat the market. I'm, as a former consultant, a bit more skeptical on that, because my world is often a bit more simple. And in our view, there are many trade-offs in life. So what we actually see is that many investments in social enterprises cannot offer the risk-adjusted returns that you might see in other areas. There are some few exemptions, but social enterprises are usually that valuable for society because they generate this positive social impact. So this impact investing sounds like a very promising concept, so you would wonder why it's not already all over the place, but it's still only a niche market, and there are different reasons for it that I want to briefly touch on. And just as an example, I brought the numbers from the German market, and you see here the overall institutional assets under management, which are quite significant, but the German market only with 70 million that are allocated towards this measurable impact is quite small. And what are the reasons for it? So together with Ashoka and McKinsey, we did a market study, and we basically identified reasons along five dimensions. And I just wanted to share the key points with you. So one of the main parts is actually the investors that are currently in. So the impact investing scene in Europe and globally is currently still mainly driven by, let's say, philanthropically motivated investors, because just the risk return profiles are not yet attracting enough for largest investor groups. There's also a point regarding the investees, so the social enterprises. We often hear from impact investors that they would be willing to invest, but that there are not sufficient investment ready social enterprises there, and that the tickets that you actually can invest are quite small. There's an issue on the intermediary side, so there are not yet many social intermediaries like FASA and others that really build bridges between social enterprises and impact investors. There are also some challenges on the market infrastructure. So the combination of charitable And for-profit business models is often restricted from a legal perspective, and that is a challenge for many social enterprises, as we see many social enterprises actually combining for-profit and non-profit models. There are also often too limited public incentives to build the market. I think one of the real exceptions to that is the European Union that promised to put 1 billion into the development of the markets for microfinance and social enterprise finance, I think up to 2024. So they're really putting money there, and I think that is a big opportunity for all of us to jointly develop the market. Yeah, I will not touch on the impact measurement that was part of the first presentation. And the last point is actually probably one of the most difficult things to change, and it's actually about perception. Because what we see in the market is that there's really a severe split between a philanthropic mindset on the one hand side and an investing mindset with pure profit orientation on the other side. And this barrier is really hard to overcome and is very challenging for social enterprises because they don't fit in either of these logics, because they often are somewhere operating in between. And the last point, I think, is also quite inherent. So there is often not a common language between social enterprises and impact investors that makes it difficult for them to operate on the same playing field. So maybe just to deep dive on some of the thoughts that I already introduced. So one of the core challenges in our view is really that social enterprises don't fit into these classical funding streams. So on the nonprofit side, you often have this -100% logic. So people are willing to lose all your money, very short-term, very project-focused. And on the other side, there's a more commercial investment logic where people looking for market rate returns and where also their investment behavior is more exit-driven, which is often challenging for social enterprises because they operate hybrid models. So they combine for-profit and non-profit elements. Sometimes they also have a for-profit and a non-profit organizational structure. They might might offer only modest returns, fewer exit options, and there's not this silver bullet one financing all solution. So this is really a challenge. And we see that actually a lot of impact potential could be between this -100% and market rate returns. And currently we see a lot of the impact in the investors in the market actually focusing on a high impact and high return niche. So it's good for the high impact, but we think it's challenging and dangerous also for the high return focus, because we see a lot of impact in the market that could actually finance with a more patient capital approach. And I think that is where the market should jointly develop. And this is one of the challenges. And the second challenge is that we really see an early stage financing gap in the market. So after some initial funding that you often can find, so in English you always talk from this family, friends and foods money, some startup grants maybe, you really enter this what is also called death valley or missing middle, where you probably need 100 to 500,000 euros after initial validation phase to further scale your business. And that is really where it's often too large then from a pure philanthropist perspective, and where it's too small and too risky for more established investors. And also given that the ticket sizes are so small and the profit potential is limited, it is from a transaction cost perspective difficult to handle. And then in the end, there would also be more money available for your later stage. But the challenge is really to build combinations in that that area. So that is actually what we are trying to do with Phase, and I keep that one. So the basic idea of Phase is to operate like a social M&A boutique, so like a social investment bank, so really supporting the social enterprises in raising hybrid growth capital, and that we have started as a spin-off of Ashoka in Germany. And we basically navigate the social enterprises through the whole process of raising these funds. So it starts with reviewing the business model and the financial model and the impact model, then structuring the financing. So is it equity or debt or mezzanine that they are using, supporting them in putting the documents together. And so we established Phase as a leading financial intermediary. I think in continental Europe there are some there are two, let's say, similar initiatives, one in the UK and one in Portugal. We actually built an open pipeline already and financed more than 30 social enterprises, raising more than 14 million euros. And I will show you some examples later on. we build it an active investor network of different philanthropists and impact-oriented investors, more than 500 persons around Europe. So it's a very heterogeneous group. I think it's also interesting to understand that there are very different actors around the table. So there are social business angels, so private persons that invest money, and also business expertise and networks. There are foundations that are going to support and invest in social enterprises. There are social venture funds that raise funds from institutional investors and invest it into social enterprises. There are public co-investment schemes. There are ethical banks. So there are many players around, and it's really important to help the social enterprises to find the right supporters at the right point in time. I think we also managed to become an accepted thought leader in the field of social entrepreneurship and social finance. So we are a member of the Gekas Group, which supports and consults the European Commission in questions of social entrepreneurship. There was also a G7 Impact Investing Task Force, where we served on the National Advisory Board in Germany. And we're also happy that the OECD described FAS as one of 20 good practice just in the social enterprise field around the world. We also got twice funding from the European Union. Maybe one theoretical slide, and then we go into the examples of the enterprises we work with. So what we find quite useful in the hybrid finance field is really to split and differentiate between different types of social enterprises. And I have two examples, one with enterprises that reach break even and those that don't. So break-even basically means a point where enterprises then have at some point higher revenues and costs. And that obviously is an easy case because depending on the characteristic of the enterprise and the exit potential, you can either use equity, mezzanine, or subordinate loan. Where it's actually more complicated is where enterprises don't have this potential. And there are interesting ways to mitigate that. So what you usually would see is, okay, if there's no profit, there's no social investment. So you can only operate with grants, but that is actually not true because you can split up the model and build a part of the business with a business model that, and there you can also then use repayable forms of financing. And on the other side, then you still have some philanthropic activities that can be financed with grant and donational money. And that often also goes along then with a hybrid organizational structure that these social enterprises have. So you have a not-for-profit arm doing the charitable activities that are financed by donations, and you have a for-profit arm doing business activities financed by investment. And just as a few examples, some social enterprises from our portfolio. So Discovering Hands, I already briefly explained. So they train blind women to detect breast cancer, and that has a double social impact. So on the one hand side, they provide employment opportunities for blind women that usually are suffering from high unemployment rates. And on the other side, you have a health prevention effect because the earlier you can detect breast cancer, the earlier you can treat it. And they have, let's say, built their business model around so-called orientation stripes that are used for the examinations of these medical text examiners. And they get 10 euros out of each examination. And that's basically the model that they build around it. And they use it as a retailer approach in Germany and as a wholesaler in other countries where they cooperate with social franchisees. And here, for example, we did, and they also have a dual hybrid structure. So they have a non-profit entity that developed the model, trains the blind women, and fosters internationalization. And they have a for-profit arm that basically sells the orientation stripes. And we concluded two financing rounds with them. One was 4 years ago with a social venture fund, a public co-investment scheme, and some business angels where we raised 500,000 euros so that they scale their model in within Germany and develop the first social franchise pilot. And then we raised another 800,000 euros just at the end of last year to increase the growth within the current markets and also to enter the market in Colombia and India. And now they plan to scale to two further countries per year. Another example is Attila von Unruh, also a German Ashoka Fellow. Also very interesting biography. So initially he founded an event company, nothing to do with impact. He sold it to someone, started something else. Unfortunately, his successor brought the company into insolvency. He was still personally liable for some of the outstanding bank loans, so he went into personal insolvency deep shit. But he stood up again and founded a movement of anonymous insolvencies, so a bit like anonymous alcoholics, so self peer group where people help each other. And even that was not the end of the story, because he discovered these people have some relevant experience that they can make useful for others, and they set up a consultants business, Team U, a turnaround consulting, where they basically people that have insolvency experience themselves, so in a self-employed or SME context, they use that to support other organizations that are in similar situations, so they either can support them in making a turnaround, or they make them to come into a structured insolvency, which then often can help to prevent the worst. And that is an interesting model that they build around. Also having a non-profit arm that does the initial support with a hotline, I think 5 hours it is for free. And they have a for-profit arm where they do the consultancy. And it also shows that it's often very small investments that are needed to start the operation. So the initial investment was only 120,000 euros. And I think it's also an interesting example of successful social enterprise models that actually turn something that is regarded as a societally disadvantage into a strength and really build a business model out of it. I think it's both with Frank and Attila a similar model. So these were two examples on the with a local or regional impact. They're also examples of social enterprises that are based in Europe but have their impact in the global south. Avamo, which basically tries to digitalize the microfinance sector in Africa and thereby increase the financial inclusion of bottom of the pyramid people. And what they are doing is they have produced a digital device that allows these microfinance providers to do all their client handling within this device, which makes it much more efficient. And they also have a fingerprint recognition, which also is a significant challenge for microfinance institutions, because it significantly improves the risk assessment. And also together with the Schufa, which is a German credit rating institute, they developed a similar credit rating system for Africa, and that allowed them to significantly increase the efficiency and the effectiveness of the credit assessment, and thereby drives down the costs. And there we put in the end actually a round together of over 1 million with different actors on board. So there were family offices, business angels, but also a public loan from the German promotional bank DEG, which was interest-free. And I think it's also a good example that you can bring different players to the table to support the growth of a social enterprise. So yeah, last it's not me, and there are many partners involved. Maybe also one word to our own model as a social enterprise. So we obviously also have a hybrid model. So we started with some support from the BMW Foundation, Apex Foundation, to family office, and now also twice support from the European Commission. But we also developed a model which basically operates with a success fee on the raised volume, and therefore we think we can establish and grow our model ourselves. So currently we are operating in Germany, Austria and Benelux, but the idea is to bring that also to further European countries and to expand our service offering to all member states of the European Union by 2022. And yeah, looking forward to your feedback and your questions. I think we have still time for 2 or 3 questions.
Markets?
No, it's actually, so currently it's Germany and Austria and Benelux countries, but we are looking for some initial pilots also in other countries. So we are just closed a mandate with an Irish Ashoka fellow. We already had here some interesting discussion with potential or with Slovenian social enterprises. So I think on a pilot basis we can already do it on a broader base, but it needs to make sense from the life cycle of a social enterprise. So currently I think we would not be in the best position to support, for example, a social enterprise in the region here to find a local investor for only maybe 50,000 euros. but I think it would make sense to support and structuring a deal, and also if there's a pan-European dimension to it. So if there, for example, some regional expansion of the model to the broader CE region, I think could be very interesting to bring also impact investors from other countries in. And I think that would be something that we could help with. So our vision is really to build an open pan-European open pipeline of investment-ready social enterprises and really build the bridge between social enterprises and impact investors. And I think it can be very complementary with, let's say, actors like GoodBiz that operate in the region and support and spend a lot of time with social enterprises reviewing and improving the impact and the business model.
I think maybe we should discuss the possibility to create something like, you know, social impact Kickstarter.
Mm-hmm.
Because divide maybe some opportunities into those that, you know, they need angel investors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like a lot of companies here,
mm-hmm.
And initiatives, because they don't have yet. And
no, that could definitely be an option. So yeah. We see in Germany, for example, there are a few crowdfunding platforms that go in that direction. So, for example, there's StartNext. They provide some grant funding for non-profit social enterprises. And there are also some established crowd investing platforms that also think about, let's say, going in that direction. And actually one ethical bank, so the GLS Bank, has just opened up a crowdfunding platform, and we currently do a deal where we do a syndication. So there's part of the investment goes via the crowdfunding, and part of the investment comes from business angels. And I think that is really the beauty of bringing different types of money and different players to the table to really find the best solution that can support the social enterprises in scaling the impact. Any further questions? If not, I'm happy to hand back, I think, to Anja.